Hello and welcome to BYJU'S. Over the last 3 weeks, we have been witnessing unprecedented political developments in Sri Lanka. In the last week of October, President Maithripala Sirisena has dismissed Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe and instead appointed Mahinda Rajapaksa as the new Prime Minister. This has triggered a series of developments which has plunged the island nation into a constitutional crisis. This ongoing political instability in Sri Lanka can have an impact on India's relations with Sri Lanka, and it can also affect Indian interests in the Indian Ocean region. So in this session, we shall analyze these developments by looking at the timeline of events and also by looking at the structural problems which exist in Sri Lanka's constitution, and finally evaluate India's stand on the ongoing political crisis in Sri Lanka. The dismissal of Ranil Wickremesinghe as the Prime Minister marked the end of an uneasy coalition between the UPFA, which was led by Maithripala Sirisena, and the UNP, which was headed by Ranil Wickremesinghe. These two leaders, they had come together in the year 2015 to form a coalition government with the primary objective of defeating Rajapaksa, who was the then president. Rajapaksa, who was the president of Sri Lanka between 2005 and 2015, was a very controversial figure. So back in 2015, Sirisena and Wickremesinghe had come together to form a national unity government or a coalition government just to overthrow Rajapaksa as the president. So we need to understand, why would Sirisena dismiss Wickremesinghe, who was a coalition partner, and go back to appointing Rajapaksa into a position of power? We should understand, why would Sirisena willingly violate the 19th amendment to the Sri Lankan constitution? We should also understand, why would Sirisena go to the extent of suspending and later dissolving the Sri Lankan parliament just in order to prevent a no confidence motion against the newly appointed Prime Minister? Sirisena even called for fresh elections after dissolving the parliament. So here, we need to understand as to why Sirisena would violate the constitutional provisions and plunge Sri Lanka into a political crisis. If we look at Rajapaksa's rule as the president of Sri Lanka between 2005 and 2015, his administration was characterized as an authoritarian regime. Both in Sri Lanka and as well as in India, Rajapaksa was considered as an authoritative figure. India and as well as the international community has accused Rajapaksa's government of committing gross human rights violations against the Tamil minorities, especially during the last phase of the civil war between the Tamil minorities and the Sinhalese majority. Rajapaksa is believed to have authorized the armed forces to use excessive force against the Tamil rebel groups. So as a result, the Sri Lankan army and the government was accused of committing human rights violations and even war crimes. And within Sri Lanka, Rajapaksa has been accused of curbing freedom of speech and expression in order to stifle dissent and opposition. That's the reason why he was considered as an authoritative ruler. And apart from this, Rajapaksa started developing very close relations with China, especially in the domain of defense and security. And India considered this pro-China inclination of Rajapaksa as a severe threat to Indian interests in Sri Lanka. India believed Rajapaksa was a pro-China leader, because under his rule, Sri Lanka entered into very close defense and strategic relations with China. China also got involved in strategic projects such as the development of the Hambantota port and as well as the Colombo port in Sri Lanka. And during his rule, Rajapaksa even permitted the docking of Chinese naval vessels and Chinese nuclear submarines. So all these developments between 2005 and 15 were considered as a strategic threat for Indian national interests. Within Sri Lanka as well, there was a lot of opposition growing against Rajapaksa, largely because of his authoritative style of governance. It was under these circumstances that Sirisena and Wickremesinghe came together despite their ideological differences and formed a national unity government in 2015 to ensure that Rajapaksa doesn't come back to power. In fact, during this period, Rajapaksa, when he lost the elections, he even accused India and its external intelligence agency, that is the Research and Analysis Wing, for engineering his defeat. India promptly denied the allegations, but India gave support to the new coalition government which was set up under the leadership of Sirisena and Wickremesinghe. But this coalition has currently fallen apart mainly because of ideological differences and differences over crucial policy decisions between the two leaders. The two leaders have not been on the same page with regard to crucial issues which are affecting Sri Lanka. So due to this ideological fallout, Sirisena decided to dismiss Wickremesinghe and bring back Rajapaksa, who was a former president, as the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka. Because Sirisena realized that Wickremesinghe was losing popularity with the public, mainly because of allegations of corruption. And he also saw that Rajapaksa was gaining his popularity back, largely by supporting the Sinhala nationalist elements. So this could be one of the reasons why Sirisena decided to violate the constitution and remove Wickremesinghe and bring back Rajapaksa. So this is where we need to talk about the structural problems which exist in Sri Lanka's constitution. Since independence, Sri Lanka has made a lot of changes to its constitutional framework. And the 1978 version of the constitution is considered as the original constitution. It was through this constitution that Sri Lanka largely adopted the French model, which provides for a strong president and a prime minister who would share powers with the president. The 1978 constitution made the president extremely powerful because he could appoint and dismiss the prime minister over the period of time. The office of the president has become extremely powerful and centralized. And especially Mahinda Rajapaksa, when he was the president, gave the office even more powers and removed all the checks and balances which existed in the Sri Lankan polity. Unlike the Indian model, which follows the Westminster system, where we have a nominal president and a prime minister who is the real executive. In case of India, the powers are largely vested with the prime minister, and the office of the president provides for a certain checks and balance in the system to ensure that there is no centralization of power and authority. But in the case of Sri Lanka, the president could accumulate powers, he could erode the powers vested with the prime minister, and as a result, the office of the president emerged as the most important and the most powerful institution in Sri Lanka. This structural flaw was further exploited by Mahinda Rajapaksa when he was the president. He removed all the checks and balances which existed. For example, he removed the cap on the number of terms that a president could enjoy. The 78 constitution had put a cap of 2 terms for a president. An individual couldn't become the president of Sri Lanka for more than 2 terms. So this provision was amended and removed in order to ensure that Rajapaksa could continue as the president of Sri Lanka. It was under these circumstances that Sirisena and Wickremesinghe had formed a coalition to ensure that the balance of power between the president and prime minister could be restored by introducing certain changes into the constitution. That's the reason why the two leaders came together to jointly fight against Rajapaksa and ensure that he was defeated in the electoral process. So immediately after winning elections in 2015, the National Unity Government brought out the 19th Amendment to Sri Lanka's constitution. Through this amendment, a number of changes were made to Sri Lanka's constitution. It tried to limit the powers of the president. It introduced a number of checks and balances wherein the president couldn't dismiss the prime minister at his discretion. The prime minister could be removed from office only under the terms and conditions which have been prescribed through the 19th Amendment. So despite introducing these changes, Sirisena himself has gone against these provisions and has willingly violated the 19th Amendment of the Constitution. And this is what creates the present constitutional crisis in Sri Lanka. So if you look at the timeline of events which have occurred over the last 3 weeks, we see that Sirisena removed Wickremesinghe and appointed Rajapaksa as the prime minister. So this constitutional violation was challenged by the Speaker of the Sri Lankan Parliament, Mr. Jayasurya, and he called for a floor test because he knew for a fact that Wickremesinghe enjoyed majority in the Sri Lankan Parliament and the appointment of Rajapaksa was unconstitutional because Rajapaksa would not be able to prove his numbers if a no-confidence motion was moved against his appointment. So when Sirisena realized that the parliament could challenge his decision and the parliament might move a no-confidence motion against Rajapaksa, he decided to suspend and even later dissolve the Sri Lankan parliament. So this was an unprecedented move because the democratically elected representatives of the people were unceremoniously dismissed by the president. So this was a gross misconduct on part of the Sri Lankan president, and this further complicated the situation. So after dissolving the parliament, the president even called for fresh elections to be conducted in January 2019. So the opposition groups, which were angered by the president's decisions, one, to remove Wickremesinghe unconstitutionally and to suspend and dissolve the parliament in an unconstitutional manner, brought out greater unity amongst the opposition groups. So the opposition parties, they came out in protest. Even few cases of violence were reported. One individual was killed during the violent protests as well. So the opposition groups, they even petitioned the Supreme Court calling for its intervention in order to protect the democratic norms and constitutional values of Sri Lanka. And a few days later, the Supreme Court, which took up the case, it has overturned the decision of Maithripala Sirisena. It has called his actions as unconstitutional. And the Supreme Court has restored the parliament and it has suspended the call for fresh elections. But the Supreme Court cannot reappoint Wickremesinghe as the prime minister because that is a power which is solely enjoyed by the parliament. So immediately after the Supreme Court's decision, the parliament reconvened and they pushed for a no-confidence vote against Rajapaksa, who was the incumbent prime minister. The vote of no-confidence was passed and as a result, Rajapaksa has been removed as the prime minister. So currently, this creates a vacuum wherein the prime minister's office is vacant and we need to wait and watch as to how things will proceed with regard to the manner in which the new prime minister would be selected and appointed. Now, let us talk about the response of India and the international community at large to the unfolding drama in Sri Lanka. Once Rajapaksa was brought back to power as the new prime minister, China and Pakistan, they immediately welcomed his appointment because Rajapaksa was a figure who was largely pro-China, and this was a situation which could favor both China and Pakistan as far as South Asian geopolitics was concerned. So India was quite alarmed when China and Pakistan immediately recognized Rajapaksa as the new prime minister. Then if we look at the Western powers, that is the United States and European powers, they criticized the dilution of democracy in Sri Lanka. They called for the protection of constitutional values and supported India's role with regard to the unfolding events. India, on its part, was closely monitoring the developments. It kept a very close watch on the events which were taking place. And it decided not to take up direct intervention because this was clearly a case of internal crisis. So any intervention from the outside, it would be seen with suspicion, both within Sri Lanka and outside Sri Lanka as well. So learning from the past experiences with countries such as Maldives, Bangladesh and Nepal, India realized that it is not useful to play a direct role in the internal crisis of another country. Especially in small neighboring countries, such a direct act of intervention would be seen as a violation of their sovereignty. This would create more anti-India feelings and it would be counterproductive to Indian interests. So learning from all these instances, especially in Nepal and Maldives, India decided not to intervene directly in Sri Lanka, and instead, it expressed open support for the protection of democratic norms and called on all the players in Sri Lanka to uphold constitutional values. In fact, we can even draw a comparison here with regard to the recent developments that have taken place in Maldives as well. Just recently, Maldives went through a major political crisis and India decided not to play a direct role because such interventions in the past have backfired on India. So the same policy has been continued for Sri Lanka right now, where the Indian government has taken a step back. It is closely watching the developments. It is encouraging the positive developments which are taking place. And it has ensured that it would play no direct role or overt public role in taking sides between an internal political crisis. So we can certainly say that India has learnt from the past experiences in the region and it has decided to play a constructive role which would further the cause of democracy and political stability in Sri Lanka. Because the biggest threat for India would be the continuation of political instability in its neighborhood. India is surrounded by a number of volatile countries. If you look at Pakistan or Nepal or Myanmar or even Bangladesh and Maldives for that matter, all these countries, they go through frequent phases of political instability. And this severely affects India's security and foreign policy as well. So it is absolutely crucial that stability is restored as soon as possible in Sri Lanka. Because at the end of the day, India cannot take sides in an internal crisis. India has to learn to deal with any political party or leader who is elected to power by the people of the particular country. So this is something that India is trying to learn and implement in its neighborhood. Before we conclude this session, let us take a look at the possible questions which can come from this particular topic. This development is very important for your mains examination. So there can be a question asking you to examine the constitutional crisis in Sri Lanka and analyze its impact on India's relations with Sri Lanka and India's interests in the Indian Ocean region. Because Sri Lanka is located in a strategic location right at the heart of the Indian Ocean. So any instability in the island nation would compromise India's interests as far as the IOR region is concerned. So this could be one of the questions. Next, UPSC can ask a question on frequent incidents of political instability in South Asia and how this affects India's security and foreign policy. You may be asked to evaluate with examples as to how India's national interests could be compromised because of these cases of instability in the region. Then finally, there could be a question on the viability of India's intervention during such cases of political instability in the neighborhood. Is it viable or is it feasible on India's part to take sides and play a direct role in such cases of political and constitutional crisis in South Asia. So these could be the possible questions which can appear in GS Paper 2 under International Relations. So with this, we can conclude the session. And if you'd like to watch more such videos on current developments, please like, share and comment on our videos and also subscribe to our channel. Thanks for watching.